your book.
Yep.
And I love it. It's
Thank
wonderful.
You.
I know you talk a lot about legalization and medical use in other states. And in the state of Minnesota, while it is medical marijuana, it's only approved for, it's not approved for symptoms of things. It's approved for diagnoses.
Well, here's your problem in Minnesota. The person I talked about that I took to Colorado that got it there and now can get it here. But here's the difference, because we're so restricted, we have to end the restrictions on it in Minnesota. We're so restricted here, they can't sell enough to bring the price down. So what costs this person $30 in Colorado a month costs the person $600 here. And believe me, your insurance don't pay for it. So that's to the point where I almost want to move to Colorado just with you're talking a mortgage here. You're talking basically a mortgage payment is how expensive. That's why talk to your legislators, tell them you want the restrictions taken off so that more people can use it, because the minute the production goes up, the price goes down, because then it becomes cost efficient for the people producing it. The other thing you're going to run into, no doctors will send you there. And that's collusion going on, I think, with Big Pharma. Because this person that I know got turned down by family physicians, the whole ball of wax, and finally had to go to a pain doctor over in a whole across the other side of the city to qualify and get to be able to get it. So we need to knock down all of that. And you know what's causing that. I'd rather have people smoke a joint or take a puff of marijuana in the evening than be on Prozac. By the way, did you see the special that Gumbel did on Denver football now? Anybody see it? I did. It was great. They went to Mile High Stadium, is now Mile High Stadium. it's appropriately named now. No, they went there, and they now have a marijuana dispensary right across the parking lot, so that when you pull into the stadium, it's right there. They interviewed the tailgaters, and they asked them, how's this working out now that you have legal marijuana as opposed to before? Every tailgater said it was 100% better. They said, we used to get here at 8:30 in the morning and start drinking, and by the time they'd open to go inside, there'd be fights and people throwing up all over the place. They said, now we get here at 11 o'clock, we smoke pot, we eat our food, we go inside and have the greatest game we've ever seen and enjoy ourselves. They went into the dispensary place right across the lot, and they talked to them. And they asked him, well, how's it working out? And they said, well, the only people that seem to come in here are the visitors. Because they said all the Coloradoans already got theirs. They don't need to come here. And right while they're filming, in comes a guy wearing the Baltimore Ravens. He's all in all the Baltimore Raven paraphernalia. And then they finished the story going to one of the most exceptional athletes, one of the most politically correct, someone who I don't think you'll ever find a bad thing about him, because I know his father, and the acorn doesn't fall far from the tree, and that was Peyton Manning. I know his dad, Archie. And they went to Peyton off camera, and Peyton, being who he is, answered what I thought was perfect. They asked him about it, and he said, well, and if you don't know, Peyton Manning is part owner to, I think, 19 Papa John's pizza franchises in Colorado. He's part owner, right? And they asked Peyton Manning about, and his answer was, well, in light of recent changes in the law, he said, my pizza stores are doing phenomenal. And I thought, what a great answer. Didn't even say the name. He just said, in light of recent changes in the law. Now, I asked the question, what's wrong with that? You know, I'll put it this way. If I had an option of going to a pot party or a drinking party after 65 years on the planet that I've been here, I'll take the pot party. Number one, the chances of violence at a pot party are slim to none. You know, if you got a troublemaker, give him a pizza, a joint, and a Hendrix. He won't bother anyone the rest of the evening. You go to the drinking party, I would say your chances of violence are about 50-50, that some violent act will occur. Second thing, I don't think I'll get thrown up at the pot party. The drinking party, someone could throw up on me. And third, if you smoked pot till 3 a.m, you could still get up at 7 and have a functioning day at work. Try drinking till 3 a.m. and get up at 7 and see if you can function at work the next day. I rest my case. Next questions. Yes, sir.
All right. Do you think if marijuana was legal, do you think Harambe the gorilla would still be alive today? Harambe the gorilla.
I don't know. Who's he?
Harambe. The gorilla?
Ooh.
No. Okay.
Oh, the gorilla. I don't know. What would marijuana have to do with that?
Well, I mean, I was just wondering, like, if the keepers or something, do you think, like, the decision would have been different?
Because of marijuana?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so. And remember, I don't advocate that you do any type of substance before you go to work. You know, many things you need to do, you can't have anything clouding your brain. When I was in the Navy underwater demolition SEAL team, I didn't do anything like that. Because when I operated, I needed a clear head. I needed to be able to think clearly and know everything I was trained to do. You know, so... No, I don't think it would have any bearing on what happened with the gorilla. In fact, I had almost forgotten about it, I guess. Yes, ma'am.
Do you think that there's still a racial element to marijuana as far as the criminalization of it? And then with the support for legalization of it, do you also support completely decriminalizing it? Because it seems to me that we could have a system where you have white men who are completely profiting off of it, while brown skin and black skin...
No, I am for complete legalization, to where poor people can grow it in their backyard if they want, be entitled to use it, and full legalization. It's economy waiting to happen. It's just like, I'll give you better. You know this wonderful, we're all pleased today, right? They're 4-0, baby.
Yeah.
But you know that big stadium you built? Back when I was governor, I gave them a mechanism. They could have built that stadium and it wouldn't have cost you a cent. But I couldn't get one legislator to even carry the bill. Remember, governors can't pass laws. Legislators do. Governor can't do that. You're not a dictator. Well, here's what it was. I pulled in top law enforcement. This is another subject now, but you need to hear it. I pulled in top law enforcement and I said, they tell me this is a $2 billion year industry. And they said, no, Governor, we think you're light. It's closer to $3 billion. Sports betting. Gambling on the games. If we legalize, they're already doing it to the tune of $3 billion a year and we get nothing for it. I say legalize it. That's what I wanted to do. I couldn't get one legislator to even carry the bill. Legalize it. The state acts as the bookie. That means we get 10% of the action. That means $300 million new dollars a year come in every year. You could have built that new Viking stadium with 4 years of sports betting profits, and then guess what? You own it and the money keeps coming in. And it would be totally on the backs of gamblers. Totally on the gamblers that follow these games. And then you might say, but, you know, and I got angry then when I couldn't do, when they wouldn't do it, no one would do it. So I went to the Attorney General and I said, I want to file charges against the Pioneer Press and the Star Tribune. They said, for what? I said, for contributing to an illegal endeavor in the state of Minnesota, because every week they print the point spread. Well, the point spread is solely for gambling. That has nothing to do with the game. The actual game, 0-0. And whoever gets the most points wins. But with gambling, you can get the, it can be like Bush Gore. You can get the most points and lose. You know, like the most voters and lose. But you get what I'm saying, yet I couldn't even get to carry the bill, and then they wouldn't go after the newspapers who are, in my opinion, are they not contributing to an illegal activity? They print the point spread every day in the paper. That's for gambling purposes. Falls under the RICO Act. RICO. The whole element but better than that, legalize it. I always told my people at the Capitol, freedom comes with a price, people. You know what that price is? If you want freedom, it comes with this price. You also have to accept the freedom to be stupid. You can't legislate stupidity. People are going to do stupid, dumb things, but that's a price you pay for freedom. And we try to legislate stupidity. Every time somebody does something stupid, well, let's make that against the law. And you don't realize that every time somebody gets a traffic violation or anything, do you realize that costs you as a taxpayer? Once it's put into that system, it requires money. So every pot smoker that gets busted costs all of us money. And I'm tired of it. I don't want to pay it anymore. I'd rather make money off it than be paying out money. I would rather be using it. And see, I'm a great believer in freedom. Now, it's stupid to do drugs. That's an act of stupidity many times. But as I said, you can't legislate stupidity and still have freedom. Because how do you commit a crime against yourself in a free society? That's what addiction is. It's allegedly addiction. How many people here are addicted to caffeine? Come on, gotta have that cup in the morning, man. Be honest. Now, what would happen if that was made illegal because caffeine is a drug and it's speed?
Right.
It picks you up.
Right.
What would happen to all of you if tomorrow they declared it illegal and you had to buy it off the black market and Jesse Ventura had 3,500 pounds of it at his house? You think I'd be a rich man if they declared it illegal? The point I'm getting to, people, we're all addicted to things, be it caffeine, be it cigarettes, be it tobacco, be it alcohol, be it marijuana. Mentally, marijuana cannot physically addict you. Mentally it can, because you like it, but physically it can't. So I wish people would really bear that in mind, that why do we insist upon treating addiction criminally when it's a medical problem? You know, you can be addicted to Hostess Twinkies. Look at obesity. Obesity is a huge problem because it leads to all these other health problems. And there's a cure for obesity. It's called willpower, eat sensible, and exercise. Three little things, and I guarantee you won't be obese. But some people are unable to do that. Well, do we put them in jail because they can't? No. And so we shouldn't be putting pot smokers in jail either. They don't belong there. I would much rather end the DEA's reign in the war on drugs and take all those DEA guys. I got a good idea. Let's put them to work catching sex offenders. I'd rather do that with my tax dollars. I'd rather have all the, they can keep their jobs. We're just gonna change their jobs. They're gonna go after so that we never have to live through another Jacob Wetterling. That's where we should be focused, not on people growing and cultivating a plant God made. Anyway, final questions. Yeah, in the back.
Yeah, do you think it might be a good idea to start investing in marijuana? Because I heard there's a law in California this November on the ballot that's going to make it legal, period, there. So like all these companies, the vapes, all these...
Well, you may have trouble because the feds still, it's illegal by the federal government yet. That's why banks can't get involved. It's a cash-only business right now, and that's how they're fighting it, because banks don't dare to get involved because then they could be roped in for laundering illegal federal drug money. See? Just like why doctors won't write prescriptions for you to go get it. You know, that's their resistance. But the people are right. This could be the issue, people. I'm gonna tell you something. The original Donald Trump people and the original Bernie Sanders people were both after the same thing. Just one's far right and the other's far left, and they can't manage to get together. What they wanted was to clean house in Washington, to end what we're seeing in Washington. They both wanted the same thing. And marijuana could be that issue, people. This is the issue where over half the country says legalize it. And yet our federal government's acting like our parent and our boss, telling us no. Well, this could be the issue where we can rise up at a state level, every state passes, and sends them the message, a big message, that we're in charge, not you. We're the boss. You work for us. You don't tell us what to do. We tell you what we want done. And marijuana could be that issue, people. Because, but you gotta get motivated. Get motivated like I am. Write to these people that are elected. Trust me, they hear your phone calls. Be polite, don't make threats, but tell them how you feel. And you know, that's how things get done. Trust me, they're out for their jobs. If they think anything will secure their job of being elected, they'll be a Hillary. You know? Well, that's what Hillary does, whatever way the wind blows, baby, she's for it now. You know, remember the trade deal? It was the gold standard of trade deals. Now all of a sudden she opposes it because the Bernie people did. And she knew she couldn't. And then that whole thing. Don't you love how we blame the Russians? The Russians are at fault for the stuff at the Democratic Party becoming public. The Russians? Well, if it wasn't written in the first place, the Russians couldn't have got it, could they? Whatever happened to that part of it? They're killing the messenger, not the message. I'll tell you how, you know why I'm offended? I now work for the Russians. I signed with RT America. They're the only ones that'll let me talk like I'm talking today. Our media won't let me, and isn't that ironic? The Russians will. The Russians will let me say my piece. It's also kind of cool to have it on your resume. Got my first check, too. It came in rubles. $10. Anyway, yes, sir.
You've mentioned medical marijuana and you've mentioned recreational, but what are...
They should both be the same.
Exactly.
They should be treated the same, medical and recreational, because those smoking it for the... quote recreational, they're doing it for their heads.
Yeah, but what I was going to say is, what are some other industries that could be affected by that? Like you mentioned, rope, like that affects the textile industry. Where
oh, you things? Can you can Willie Nelson doesn't just smoke pot, people. Willie Nelson powers his tour buses with biodiesel fuel made from marijuana. Willie puts his money where his mouth is. Believe me, he's one of my heroes. You know, and no, Willie powers his buses with it makes the best biodiesel fuel on the planet. It grows 15 feet every summer. It's renewable. If you let the seeds fall on the ground, it'll grow again next summer, and it'll keep doing it. And you get clothing out of it. You get biodiesel fuel. The list goes on and on and on. All of these things this wondrous plant can provide. And yet, what have we been doing? Eradicating it. I think the people that eradicate it should be the ones going to jail for not allowing the public to have use of this fantastic plant. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Yeah, did your administration sell many tax stamps?
Did my administration sell many tax stamps?
Yes.
I have no idea if we sold any at all.
The marijuana tax stamps that were...
That's federal.
The Minnesota state tax stamps?
I didn't even know it existed. But I knew there was federal that way, but I didn't know Minnesota had it. And I tried to legalize it. I couldn't even get no one to carry the bill. I wanted to start with hemp. Let's legalize hemp. I mean, you could smoke 2 tons of it. It doesn't do nothing to you.
I remember when you were on the radio with Jason Lewis, and you were discussing the betting, sports betting. And I remember you schooled him well in timing and going to the break and coming back and then revealing how you were going to finance the sport, the new stadium.
Oh, yeah. But I couldn't because no one had carried the bill, so guess who got to do it?
Smokers.
And I can't.
Thank goodness they're 4-0. Imagine if they were 0-4 up history. But they're winning, so we can overlook it now. They've given me my entertainment. How many are watching tomorrow? I am. See? Always remember now, we in the United States, if you want to read history, you should do it. As soon as you read about the United States, you'll realize you can call us Rome. We get involved in wars all the way around the other side of the earth that have no bearing on us, drain us of all of our economy. Our economy itself is based upon entertainment. You know, entertainment takes the number one priority because look who we pay the most, entertainers. Who makes more than sports guys do? Because they can entertain you. You know, so you have to face up to what we are. We're an entertainment society.
So knowing what we know about the tobacco industry and how they've damaged people's lungs and got them in the marijuana industry, where they're going to link it to COPD and all the other lungs?
No, because nobody makes you do it. Remember when I talked about freedom? Well, freedom comes with the freedom to be stupid. And you have that right to be stupid. And if you get damaged, it was your choice to do it.
With that being said, there is a direct link with smoking and lung disease and lung cancer.
But there's never been a case where somebody smoked pot and got it. Now, maybe there are, but the point being is that that's a choice you make. You're not physically addicted to marijuana like you are physically addicted to tobacco.
Understandable, but all you need is that one doctor to say, all right, now we're linking lung cancer to marijuana intake, because the only thing that...
Well, what will that do? Tobacco has been linked to it for decades. Has it curtailed tobacco sales? No. They can still sell it. You can die from binge drinking. There's 300,000 drunk drivers a day, that drive in the United States of America. 300,000 are drunk. Now, if they get caught, they go to jail. But how many of them are not getting caught? It's called the price of freedom. I talked about it. Freedom comes with a price. And you have the freedom to be stupid.
Or eat brownies.
You know? Yeah. Marijuana comes with edibles. If you don't, and it also now the new way too is the vaporizing.
Yeah.
My friend Woody Harrelson, I think, was instrumental in coming, because Woody used to always tell me, Woody's a complete vegetarian, and he lives such a perfect, and he used to complain to me, Woody, the only bad thing I do is smoke pot. I've got to find a way that's healthier. And I think he was very instrumental in the discovery of the vaporized method. Do you know that method? Where it doesn't actually burn, but it goes to a temperature that allows what needs to get off the pot. Without an actual burning taking place. And like you said, there's edibles.
I just fear that that's going to be some of the people that are against it. That's going to be their argument.
Oh, that'll be their argument, because they're told to argue that. Yeah. The real argument is you can grow it for free.
Well,
that's the truth.
That tobacco.
That's,
you can do it with tobacco.
No, you can't.
You can't grow tobacco.
Yeah, you can. How many backyards have you seen tobacco in?
About as many as I've seen marijuana in.
If marijuana were legal, you would see it in a lot of backyards.
Growing up on the south side of Minneapolis, it was not in very many.
I grew up on the south side of Minneapolis.
You saw a lot more tomatoes than you did that.
Sure, because it's illegal. If it were legal, I'd have seen as much of that as I did tomatoes. That's your difference. One's legal, the other isn't.
And back to the tobacco growing it yourself versus not. One's legal, then you just don't see it. You just don't see it.
Nobody grows tobacco. I challenge you to show me one private house in the state of Minnesota that grows tobacco in their backyard. Yes, sir.
Yeah, do you think we'll ever get legalization as long as there's still private, for-profit prisons?
Yeah, because Obama's ordered the closure of the private prisons now. He's ending it, which is a tremendous move of what he's doing.
Yeah.
To get rid of these privatized prisons, because the thing you have to remember there is that government, this is a big difference that Trump needs to understand too, is that government is there to provide services. Corporations are there to provide profits to their shareholders. So when you take something that's the public good and you privatize it, then it's required that it has to make a profit so that the stockholders can make money, because that's who they answer to. So in the case of prisons getting privatized, it requires them to be near capacity in which to show a profit. So then it becomes a profit-making scheme to put people in prison for smoking pot or possessing pot to keep the prisons full so that the corporate prison structure can earn money. And there's another thing going on. It's called basically sweatshops. Corporations are then subcontracting with the corporations that run the prison, and they get their labor for a dollar an hour or whatever from prisoners inside, that then they produce the product that the corporation then sells for who knows how much more profit. And of course the prisoner doesn't have any benefits or any rights, although he's in there, he gets three hots and a cot, you know, and he can go see the doctor, I guess. But when he's producing something that, say, he's making 50 cents an hour on, and they're selling it the equivalent of 10 bucks, well, that isn't that nice for the corporation. And so that's the danger of privatization of government. Government's there to provide services, not necessarily produce profits. Corporations have to produce profits for their stockholders. So that tends to run the price up even more. Yes, sir?
Have you heard that Jill Stein and
good for her. It doesn't surprise me. I met Jill in Moscow in December.
She seemed like such an amazing person to be running.
She is. She's a remarkable person, and that doesn't surprise me at all. Dr. Jill Stein will legalize and let everybody out, and I agree with that.
Do you also believe that the polls are definitely skewed against her?
The polls are skewed against all third-party candidates because they get no media coverage. Attaining that 15% is unattainable, because the third party's lucky if they get 0.5% of the media coverage. 99.5% goes to the major two parties. So even I, when I ran in one here, at Labor Day, I was polling 9 to 10% in 60 days because I was allowed in the debates. I won. But see, I couldn't have qualified federally. I wouldn't have gotten the debates because I wouldn't be high enough. And that's where the two parties control it, and they work good together, don't they? When it comes to keeping the third party out, boy, they sing kumbaya with each other then. They're right there for that, you know? And so you're never, so when Trump says the elections are rigged, they are. They're rigged so that you only get two choices, basically. That's where they're rigged. You don't get to hear a third alternative on that debate stage. And in order to win, you gotta be up there. That's what won it for me. They made the mistake. The politician let the pro wrestler up there. Guess who's gonna win the argument every time? Taught that at Harvard, people, how pro wrestling prepares you for politics. In the John F. Kennedy School of Government, that was one of my classes. And I think the kids at Harvard understood. You know that's my school now, don't you? No, I never went to college, and Harvard's the only university when I came out of governor that offered me a fellowship. Minnesota didn't, even though I was governor here, but Harvard did. So my loyalty's with the Crimson now. That's where, you know, I now belong to the Minnesota Harvard Club. You know, with, what's her name? Carlson? That owns Carlson? She's Harvard too. We're all part of the Harvard Club. Who'd have thunk it? I only went to high school. But I taught at Harvard. Only in America, people. And things like that happen, and we need to keep it that way. Any last questions? Yes, sir.
I can only assume that your personal military history was a positive one for you, but if it were 2016, you were an 18-year-old now, would you do it over?
No. He asked me if my military thing was a positive for me, and then if I had to, and knowing what I know today, if I was 18 years old today, would I do it again? And I said, no. I follow the teachings, people, today, when it comes to war and when it comes to defense and all that, of Major General Smedley Darlington Butler. And a lot of people maybe don't know who Major General Butler was, but Major General Butler was a Marine who served about 100 years ago during what they called the Banana Wars in Central and South America. And he had the quote that he didn't serve the American people, this is 100 years ago. He didn't serve the American people, he served the United Fruit Corporation. Whenever they'd go into Central or South America, if they didn't get cooperation, they'd send in the Marines to get it. Now, they don't like you to read his book. I personally, if I was governor again, I would do everything in my power to make sure that it was required reading for all high school seniors in which to graduate. The title of the book is War is a Racket by Major General Smedley Darlington Butler. Now they'll try to minimize Major Butler and they'll try to smooth him over, but they can't. There's nothing they can do about it. You know why? Because Major General Butler didn't win one, he won two Congressional Medals of Honor. Two, not one. It's remarkable anyone to win one. Major General Butler won two. And when he tells you war is a racket, I think you should listen, because he's someone who would know. And that's what I base my policy on. And General Butler says that we need to pass a constitutional amendment that our military can't go over 500 miles from our shore. That way they're protecting the United States of America, what we're paying them to do. If you need the borders guarded, let the U.S. military do it, if you feel that inclined. But why do we have 170-some bases throughout the earth? It was interesting. Vladimir Putin was interviewed a few weeks ago by a BBC guy who was really getting on him about Russian aggression. And President Putin said, well, let's put this into common sense for a moment, very calmly. He said, Russia has two bases outside of Russia in the whole world. The United States has 173 or something like that. Who's the aggressor? Put it into common sense. Two or 170 plus. Who would you think the aggressor is? So, yeah, I'm proud of my military service, but I'm proud today. See, I was asked once by Jason Lewis. I told him that going to war was really a simple, easy decision. And Jason, of course, differed with me greatly and said I was ridiculous and that going to war is the hardest decision anyone could make. And I followed saying, no, it's an easy decision. I said, it's easy in the fact of this. A war is justified if you're willing to send your kids. If you're not willing to send your kids, then how do you send someone else's? And I can tell you unequivocally, the Iraq War, I would not have sent my kids to any of these wars. I'm proud that my kids aren't involved in these wars, because they're not wars to protect us. What, ISIS is going to do a Normandy invasion in Virginia? if we get out of there, they wouldn't be bothering us. The problem is we've got our nose in their affairs, which is what we do today. And I call me an isolationist, but I look around my great country of the United States today, and I see a whole lot of shit here we gotta fix. We got a whole lot of stuff right in this country we gotta fix. Why are we throwing $1 trillion away for something halfway around the world that really and truly doesn't affect any one of us, does it?
Because war is a racket.
That's right, because war is a racket. What Smedley meant by that is that they sell you on a patriotic theme of why the war should happen, when the reality of it is it's there for people and to make profit and money. Case in point, Vietnam, a company called Brown, Brown and Root got the dredging of Cameron Bay for $1 billion. They got the job to dredge Cameron Bay so our ships could get in there. Do you know who Brown, Brown and Root is today? Halliburton. All they did was change their name. They're war profiteers, and they change their name every decade or two so that you don't catch on. You know, well, we got a new name now, we're Halliburton. By the way, who was the CEO of Halliburton before he became VP?
Cheney.
Dick Cheney. What was his severance package, his parachute? $34 million for 5 years at the helm of Halliburton, and nothing particularly great happened? Yet he got a $34 million severance package. Was that for the upcoming job? I didn't say that. I just offered it up for thought. Is that for the upcoming job that he commissioned? You know, I don't know. Anyway, thank you very much. We'll sign some books. Appreciate it.